The story goes that in the beginning, God created two people, and their name was Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. God told them, don't eat from the tree. Mm-hmm. But you know what they did instead? They decided that they're going to take all of God's gifts and design, and they're going to go their own way. He could have made them like a bird. He could have made them like any other animal in the world. But he says, I'm going to create one creation that I'm going to let them decide. And when Adam and Eve did what they did, this word comes into the picture. You have any idea what this word means?
Sin.
Yeah. What letters in the middle of the word is sin?
I.
So anytime I do what I want to do, Adam and Eve did exactly what they wanted to do. But they got what they wanted, but they didn't want what they got. Because the Bible says their eyes were open. And what happened to their human heart is that it went from being whole, and their heart was what?
Broken.
It was broken. They started running from God for the first time. And God told Adam, Adam, what have you done? You know what Adam said? He says, that woman you gave me, she made me do it.
What he was ungrateful.
He was ungrateful. He was blaming the creator for making him like that and giving him a wife. I just went to sleep and woke up and I was married. That ain't my fault. He went to the woman. What did the woman say?
The woman must have said something.
The serpent made me do it.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the snake, and the Bible says that the snake really didn't have a leg to stand on. Bible says God cursed the serpent, which means the devil was cursed. At some point, even though you led human race into sin, at some point I'm going to crush your head.
Uh-huh.
Genesis 3 and 15 says, you think you won, but I'm going to send somebody to ultimately crush your head. And what he's doing is he's predicting the Savior is going to come and ultimately crush the head of the serpent. Anytime you sin, you start trying to cover it up. And you use four different ways to try to cover up your sin. You feel this. Even though you may not believe God exists, you'll do these things. You'll run towards other people to try to feel better. Mm-hmm. Sexual relationships, or you try to fit in with a friend group. And what you'll find out is broken people can't fix broken people. They're just as messed up as you are. You can't even depend on them for too long, and they'll disappoint you. That's what Adam and Eve did. They try to use each other to fix each other. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know what a bungee cord is?
Bungee cord.
You strap a bungee cord to the wall and you anchor it around your waist and you take off walking and running. You feel this sense of freedom. Until what?
Until
it brings you right back to your broken heart. The other thing people try to run towards to fix their empty void is they'll run towards riches, success. And they feel like if I can just get to that point and make that money or get that car or take that vacation and get to this house or get that wife, or I'll finally be free. I'll finally feel whole. But you know what ends up happening?
There's no happiness in that.
No happiness. Some of the most miserable people in the world are the most wealthiest, financially successful people. You know who Robin Williams is? He's an American actor.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Jackson. All of them drugged themselves to death. They killed themselves. You ever heard of the lottery curse?
No, but I get what you mean.
75% of the lotto winners are bankrupt or extortion.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. So we know that even financial success, man, is only going to leave you right back in your brokenness. It just can't fix you. The other thing people try to run towards is a thing called runs. Now, I tore my ACL, and it doesn't heal on its own. But I was popping these pain pills, and I felt good for the moment. But it didn't fix the pain. It just made me feel better in my pain. Well, when people are sinning, they feel this broken void, and what they'll do is they'll do things to try to feel better to cover up that pain that they feel inside. Smoking weed, or drinking, or going to parties, or watching pornography, playing video games, or going shopping, or spending a bunch of money, or some people have even contemplated suicide because they just can't stand the pain.
Mm-hmm.
They cut themselves, they play sports all the time, mm-hmm. and they're consumed with these things, and you almost feel like they worship them, because if it, the way they don't have them, they're just ready to die.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So even runs, it just gives you a temporary relief, but it doesn't really fix, it doesn't cure you. And so if at some point, even though it feels good, you're coming back to that brokenness. Now here's the last one. It's going to answer your question about religion. Another thing people try to use to fix their empty void is they'll run towards religion. And they feel like they'll try to keep these rules. They'll have all these different laws. Okay, if I can just appease this guy by keeping the law, keeping these rules, maybe I'll get to his status. And all of a sudden, they start keeping these rules, and they go, this is not changing me. I'm still running towards this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still running towards this. This God is supposed to change me, but I still feel empty.
It's not about the rules. It's about where your heart is at.
Yes. Yes, and I'm going to give you even more where you should put your heart at. But man, religion, even in America, people go to church, they tithe, they do all, they sing, they preach, but at the end of the day, there's not been a change in their life.
Because and here's, their heart is not at the right place.
It's not at the right place. And eventually what people do is they become atheists because they say, this don't even make any sense, because they're trying to keep rules to appease this God that they feel like if they I can just do enough. And what it does is rules will just weigh you down. Mm-hmm. And you just say, man, forget all of this because I want my sin. Like, sin is enjoyable. Sin is fun. But they'll use religion to try to check that box off. And you know what type of people killed Jesus in the Bible?
The same ones who run towards religion. And
religion. Mm-hmm. He was against religion that didn't really have a change of heart. Mm-hmm. So, man, I tried this. And, man, it just left me broken. Now, let me tell you why we do this. Let me tell you why we run towards these things. You guys got a car?
No, I don't.
Well, you know what a check engine light is when something happens? But when the check engine light comes on, do you just take out a hammer and punch out the check engine light? No. That's foolish.
No, I repair it.
You go, it's something on the inside of the car that needs to be repaired. Mm-hmm. All of these things that people run towards, relationships, riches, runs, and religion, they are just check engine lights that people try to use to try to punch out the check engine light because something's wrong on the inside of humanity. This is what's wrong. We're all what? Sinners. We're sinners. And we try to use these things to try to punch out the check engine light, but we don't fix the inside of the problem. Let me show you what the inside of the problem is, okay? In commandments. They're commandments and laws that only show you that you can't keep them. So let me give you an example. And this is no disrespect towards you. I used to do this myself.
You can see anything I do.
You're so kind. People, B stands for blasphemy. People blaspheme God by either saying he doesn't exist or they live like it. It's people in here, the BCM. They say God exists, but they live like he doesn't. That's blaspheming God. Mm-hmm. Would you say you guys are guilty or not guilty?
Of blasphemy?
Yeah. Well, you said it already. That God doesn't exist.
God since then, yeah, I am.
Guilty. And guess what?
Same here.
We all there, right?
So I'm gonna because put a, we are all the same.
Yeah. I'm a big fat chick for all of us. Mm-hmm. How many lies have you told in your life?
A few days ago, I don't know.
How about you?
A lot, but I'm trying to improve.
Put a check for all of us. A stands for adultery. You know how we break this standard? You know what adultery is?
You mean like
having is sex with somebody else's wife or
physical
husband.
Connections?
Yep.
Like that were not legal.
Right. Jesus comes and he raises the standard of what adultery really means.
You've heard the commandment that says you must not commit adultery, but I say anyone who even looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her. In his heart.
Have you ever, I'm guilty
of it. Yeah. Yes, have you ever watched pornography? You ever had sex outside of God's design, which is marriage? Guilty. Guilty as charged, right? We'll put a check for all of us. M stands for murder. Do you know how we break the standard according to what Jesus said?
If you hate someone,
you're a murderer. So since you already know that, I won't show you that. Mm-hmm. Guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
You said that fast. E stands for exalt. This is to exalt something above God. And so, no disrespect, but you've already done that. You have taken God off the throne and said, God doesn't exist, and say, man, I'm my own person. I run my own, right? And I'm not, no disrespect, we all done that.
No,
you're so awesome. You're so awesome, man. So, look at what letters in the middle of the word sin.
All right.
So, when I do what I want to do instead of what God wants, we have just exalted ourselves above the man who made the standard. Mm-hmm. That's the number one commandment that the Bible says, you should not have any other God before me. Also God, but we worship the sun and the moon and animals and everything. We worship everything, jobs, our sexuality, who we are, our money, right? So we're guilty of exalting things above the true creator. And then S stands for steal. Have you ever stolen anything, even if it's cheating on a test and stealing answers?
Guilty as charged.
If God exists and you were to stand before this righteous God, how much good could you do to pay him off?
There's no enough.
Not even a month.
Because, like, I've done so bad. Like, I've done this.
There's no way.
And there's no way I can make it up to him.
So if hell is real, if God is real, he has a place where he separates people. And if you stood before God tonight, 170,000 people die collectively around the world every single 24 hours. And most people are going to spend eternity separated from his God because we're all have sinned. So if you die in your brokenness tonight, and if hell is real, the Bible says God will do what a good judge does because we deserve it. And most people think they can be religious enough to pay off their debt after what they've done. It'd be like me and you get up in a plane, and I say, hey, guys, you're going to jump out of this plane, and you got to flap your arms as hard as you can. How are you going to do in the end?
Sounds ridiculous to me to begin with.
That's good advice. I gave you the best advice I could. You know what religion is? Religion says, just work as hard as you can. Just try to appease this God as much as you can. And maybe, just maybe, you can pay off your debt. And in the end, guess what? You can't do enough.
Mm-hmm. It's never enough.
It's never enough.
Even in the court of law, you can see it now. Like, let's say somebody's on trial for a crime that they committed. And imagine that they try to tell the judge, like, hey, judge, like, I've done all these good things. I think you should let me off the hook, right? But the judge would say, like, we're not here for the good things that you've done. We're here for the crimes that you committed, right? So it wouldn't work. Like, if you're, like, trying to plead to the judge, like, I've done all these good things, that's not why you're in the courtroom to begin with, right? So there's not an amount of good things in your life that you can say to get this judge to get you off the hook.
Yeah, that's actually a good example. Like, if, let's say a murderer.
Yeah, exactly.
A murderer stands up in front of court and he says, like, I've been, you know, feeding homeless people.
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
And now I killed one guy, it doesn't mean that I'm a bad guy. No, you did something which was horrendous.
You have to pay for it.
I mean, maybe you have helped homeless guy, mm-hmm. and we are grateful for that. Mm. But then you took someone's loved one from them.
Mm. You can't pay that off.
You can't pay it off.
You can never make it up to them.
Yeah. All right, so we track it. So if God is this, he has to be a good judge, and he'll do what a good judge does, and he'll send people separated from him in a place called hell. Jesus is a real human figure that lived in human history. This is not science. I'm telling you, Jesus historically lived as a figure, and people, first century historians, are writing about this man. Go look it up. That was doing extraordinary things that nobody has ever seen. It's historically proven. He became a man because he knew that human beings were not going to be able to keep the standard. So he sent the standard to us. Jesus was perfect. He became a man. He never sinned. He never broke any of God's standards.
Even the devil made him do things. Like, he tried to make him. Yeah, he was like, jump off this cliff, do this, do that, and he did.
He completely was obedient to the Father. And the Bible says God sent him in the place of mankind's sin. So 2,000 years ago, God knew that we couldn't keep the standard. So for God so loved the world that he gave his son. There's no amount of good we could have do to get to him. So he made a provision to get to us. And the Bible says God took the blame of the world. And he says, I don't want you to be religious enough to get to me because you couldn't do it. But I loved you enough to come to you. And I have perfection in me. And if you would do two things, when the Bible says that Jesus went on the cross and he says the last words, he says, it is finished. Meaning he has paid the debt of mankind's sin. And he's hoping that you will appreciate what he's done. And the Bible says God is full of mercy based on what the Bible says. And he's willing to extend grace to mankind and recognizes that they...
I mean, even when he was getting crucified, like, he was praying to God that, please forgive them.
But they don't know what they do. So look, this is not a religion. A religion says, I have to try to appease this God that I cannot appease. That's going to get you separated from... This is a relationship. That even when you don't meet the standard, I'm right there with you. Like, when my son doesn't meet the standard, daddy helps him. He doesn't kick him out and kill him. Or what the Bible says, God wants to be your father through his son, Jesus. Mm. And that even when you can't keep the standard, he's right there catching you. In America, they do the electric. They used to do the electric chair. So let's just say they give you the electric chair. You sit in the seat. Execution puts his hand on the switch. And he's about to flip the switch on you. To everybody's surprise, the good judge, the rightful, righteous judge, comes in. And he's holding his two-year-old innocent son in his hand. Tears are running down his face. He kisses his son one last time and takes his keys out of his pocket and hooks your chains. He tells you to stand next to the chair. But he kisses his son and puts his son in your place while you're standing next to the chair. Strap his little bit of your arms in, put the electrical bucket on his head, goes out of the room and puts his hand on the switch. With tears in his judge's eyes, he flips the switch, execute his innocent son for a guilty murder. Judge comes back in the room and he falls on his hands and knees and he looks at you and he says, are you willing to receive my mercy? I've showed you. I've just executed my son for you. If you accept it, you can walk out of here with no penalty, but my son has paid your fine. You only got two choices. You can either accept what the judge has done with the son, or you can reject it. If you accept it, how would you live your life according to his mercy?
Try to be as righteous as
you can.
It's not to get the debt paid.
No one can be perfect, but you can at least try.
Absolutely. Mm. Because of the mercy. And now your whole life is motivated by the mercy of the judge. Mm. Now, at first, you were just trying to do good, not to go to the electric chair, but you couldn't keep the standard. But now you want to do good because of the mercy. He's prevented you from going to the electric chair. He's paid your fine by executing an innocent person for you. It was hard for him to give up his son.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's what the Bible says that God did for you. Even though you couldn't keep the standard, he loved you so much that 2,000 years ago, he sent his son, and he executed Jesus. He took the wrath that you and I deserved, and in response to what Jesus did on that cross for you, you must do two things. You must repent and be sorry for you trying to think you can flap your arms. And if you acknowledge what he did on the cross and say, God, I'm willing to give you my whole entire life. I can't be perfect, but I'm willing to be perfected, and by your mercy, I'm going to do the best I can because of the mercy you showed me. And on the day of judgment, the Bible says, God says, paid in full. He will not charge hell against you because Jesus paid it. He can legally let you walk into heaven without God looking like he's a bad judge. He paid the fine by sending his son. Mm-hmm. That's repent. That's being sorry. And I'm just saying repent and believe. Repent, repent, and put your faith totally in Jesus. And the Bible says, God will show you mercy. And on the day of judgment, when you stand before God, God sees you as if you were blameless. Why? Because he don't longer have to punish you. He's punished his son on your behalf. You can walk into heaven as if you never sinned and take you back to the original design. Either you'll pay for your sin or you'll let Jesus pay for it on the cross. That's why we worship Jesus as the only one true God. When you put your faith in him, the debt has been paid, and he starts a relationship with you right where you sit. That's the whole story of the Bible. If you can understand this story, you can understand the whole Bible from there, because the whole story is about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Bible is the number one read book in the world. So either he's lying, he's crazy,
or he's true.
Or he's who he said he was. You have to make the decision. That's the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
So, man, tell me what you're thinking, man. What you really thinking?
I mean, I believed in God, and I still do. And I'm trying to get better. So, I mean, this talk was helpful, but I would still say that I'm...
You're on the fence.
Mm-hmm. Because I would say that I am on his side when I'm truly, in my conscience, that I'm doing right.
Yes.
Yeah. And until then, I'm just sitting on the fence. Okay. Because I can never be as good as him, or, you know, as good as a lot of people, but I'm trying.
Okay, that's the point. Mm-hmm. That's the point, is that even if you try, you can never meet the standard.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he sent his son.
Mm-hmm.
Because
yes, I do believe in God, but it's still just, I have to satisfy my own conscience.
I see. Yeah. Will you do me a favor? You got a Bible at home?
Yes, I do.
I want you to start reading the book of John.
Mm-hmm.
The book of John is going to give you an up-close and personal view of who Jesus is. And as you begin to read about Jesus, you'll begin to find out he's who he said he was.
Mm-hmm.
And at that moment, you don't have to try no more. All you have to do is put your faith in Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And when you say, man, just tell God, I'm sorry. I recognize what you've done on that cross, and I'm ready for you to make you Lord of my life. Now, what you're probably going to struggle with, and I'm going to tell you, I struggle with this, but you're going to struggle with it probably even more, is that if I follow Jesus, you know what that says about your family? That's a tough call. That if I follow Jesus, I forsake all, and he's the only, and I'm willing to do anything he says. If I have to lose my life to follow him, and most people were not willing to give up their life and their culture to follow Jesus. And so you'll have to struggle with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so tell me, is there anything that's keeping you from wanting to follow Jesus? What are you wrestling with from really putting, if this is true, what's the thing that's going to keep you from really following Jesus?
Nothing's keeping me. If it's meant to be, it's going to happen.
It's going
to
happen.
So one thing that I have to say is, like, there was this one analogy that I saw one time where it's basically like this guy, right? He fell in the ocean, right? But he was holding on to, like, a money belt, right? Something that was really weighing him down. And and because of it, he drowned because he wasn't willing to let go. And what I would say is, because with it, one thing that you can do, because that's really something that I get a lot often, like, if there's so many religions, how can Christianity be true? I want you to think about this, right? If you had a set of parachutes in front of you, right? One was full of holes, one was dingy, one was beaten up and torn up, and one had like 25% chance of working. But there was one that was a really good parachute that 100%, like, it's going to work if you use it, right? If you test each and every one of these, you're going to realize that the other ones aren't true. right? But it comes down to you being willing to test it, right? And you shouldn't hold on to the things that you've accumulated right now, because if this is truth, that it's means it's the most important thing that you could ever have, right? Because otherwise, you're going to be jumping out of an airplane with something that's not going to work. And instead of going to the ground 8 miles per hour, you're going to go 150 miles per hour and splat, right? So I say this to, like, encourage you to, like, not be closed off, be like, oh, like, I've already, like,
made
my mind up, right? Like, test it. Like, look at Christianity.
Look at the evidence.
Just look at the, because the realization is, if you can disprove that Jesus didn't, resurrect, then Christianity is pointless.
Yeah.
Right? We're all, Jesus is the best deceiver ever to exist, right? The number one sold book in the world is the Bible, right? And if that many people are willing to read this lie, it's like, he's the best deceiver in the world.
Yeah.
I'm not saying, like, people shouldn't believe in it. Mm. I'm just saying, like, it doesn't make sense to me in particular.
Yeah. Mm.
I'm just saying that. I'm not saying, like, I might be wrong here.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
What he practiced, like Hinduism, that may be true. Christianity may be true. I don't know what is true.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
So I just believe, like, yeah, nothing is true.
Mm. Yeah.
That's my thing.
He's saying, he, like, made a logical statement. Are you willing to test it out? Go examine the evidence for yourself. And what you'll find is that parachute.
But the thing is, like, I can't examine this thing. How can I examine, like...
Yeah, just go look at the historical facts. Go look at the first century historians, what they said about Jesus. Go look at the stuff they digging up in Israel. It's all confirmed in Scripture. It's 100% true, man.
The same way that, like, for a person, like, let's say somebody was like, gravity doesn't exist. You could test it and show it to them that this is true, right? Because gravity, you can't see it. You can't, like, it's not something tangible, right? But you can test it and prove that it is truth.
Yeah, you can see the evidence.
You could see the evidence and be like, yeah, that there's no way that it doesn't exist, right? Mm-hmm. So,
Just go test it out. And I'm going to pray, man, that God would expose himself to you guys. Mm-hmm. If it's true, he's going to come for you.
He's going to come for you.
Everything is part of the plan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Say it again.
Everything is a part of the plan.
It's part of the plan. He's going to come for you. Mm-hmm. And when he comes for you, don't try to punish. We're going to pray hard that he comes for you. And the next time we come back here, I'm going to pray that God has exposed himself to you in a way that's very clear. He's done it to multiple people. I'm going to pray hard. Okay? Y'all got any other thing? Man, I love you guys, man. Can we just at least pray for you guys?
Sure.
Okay.